Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Innal hamdalillah nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lahu wa man yudlil fala hadiya lahu wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lahu wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh ya ayyuhalladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وبعد Your Excellency the Executive Governor of Kebbi State Senator Alhaji Abu Bakar Attahiru Sifawa Your Excellency the former Speaker of the Federal Republic of Nigeria Honorable Oladimeji Bonkole, Your Excellency, the wife of the State Executive Governor, Hajia Dr. Zainab Shinkafi-Bagudu, other members of State Executive Council here present, other distinguished personalities, the guest lecturers, our distinguished Dr. Sheikh Jabir Sani Mehullah, who is here present, and Sheikh Ismail Menk and Sister Naima to that joining us virtually. Distinguished brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I stand here before you to represent our eminent scholar, Sheikh Abu Bakar Giro Argungu, who is unavoidably absent because of his engagement away in Niger State, delivering this year's tafsir. And you are all aware with his recent health condition, as a result of which it was clear to him that he could not be able to be here with you. And that is why he instructed me to come and deliver the paper on his behalf. You know, I cannot be in the shoes of our eminent Sheikh. So I'm only trying to make a sense of what the message the Sheikh is trying to pass. And the title of his paper is Innovative Islamic Ways of Home Management in COVID-19 Era. The paper is trying to look at Islamic perspective or approach to home management during this critical period of COVID-19. As you are all aware, COVID-19 pandemic, the word and vocabulary is now a household name in Nigeria and globally. We all know what COVID-19 is. The pandemic is being caused by coronavirus. And we are all aware of its attendant fatality world over. So up till this moment, there is no genuine or established cure for the coronavirus. And that is why the major preventive measure against coronavirus is that of social distancing, stay at home, and other related measures. Therefore, one of the drastic changes that the COVID-19 brought to human society has been resort to sedentary life. People are now used to being indoors in their homes more than ever before. And because of that, that is what informed this topic. Now that people are always used to remaining indoor, trying to run away from the infectious coronavirus disease, then that will delay the significance of home management mechanism. And that is why the Sheikh is invited now to give Islamic perspectives or Islamic innovative ways of that home management during this critical period. As I said, he tried to explain COVID-19, which, as I said, is already a household vocabulary now. So I will rather move to the area where the Sheikh was trying to explain some of the preventive measures against coronavirus. That today there is no reliable cure for COVID-19 better than precautionary measures. The ongoing advances in the invention of vaccine has not been perfected to serve as a reliable cure against the COVID-19. In fact, questions as to whether if the vaccinated fellow is fully immunized against the virus are still not satisfactorily answered. Consequently, preventive measures are the best way of managing the COVID-19 pandemic. Some of the necessary measures to prevent the spread of COVID-19 include public enlightenment and awareness. That means educating the general public about the danger of the disease and the possible ways to prevent oneself and the community from being infected from the virus. Then avoiding an infected person, that means social distancing. Avoiding contact with objects, particularly iron and silver made objects in public places. Staying at home as much as possible throughout the period of the pandemic. Then wearing face masks to cover nose and mouth when there is genuine excuse to connect to public places. Then avoiding touching your eyes, your nose, your mouth, and other related organs. Then avoiding exposure to human and animal secretions. Then regular washing of hands with soap and running water. Well-informed handling of domestic utensils, physical or social distancing measures at home, proper handling of children's waste, particularly by mothers who are the caregivers, proper handling of pets, such as dogs and cats, effective home management, particularly during indoor observance or lockdown to comply with health specialist guidelines, that means the COVID-19 protocol, observing and reporting symptoms from any member of the family, preventing unnecessary exposure of children, then ensuring proper hygiene or cleanliness of the home environment. So these are some of the measures through which an individual can prevent himself from becoming infected with the COVID-19 or coronavirus. Then home management during COVID-19 era. Dangers associated with the COVID-19 pandemic resulted to stay-at-home measures worldwide, including such drastic measures as curfews and lockdowns for many weeks, many days, many months at different countries, states, or regions around the world. The fact that preventive measures are the only, or at least the best way of preventing the spread of COVID-19, families, communities, and nations have resorted to increased sedentary life since the spread of COVID-19, like never before. The manner at which both parents, mothers, fathers, children, household, and domestic staff are staying indoor for longer hours, sometimes undergoing the stress of curfew and lockdown, has brought about considerable stress to households. Homes are overstressed. Household resources such as food, energy, water, amenities, and social services are equally overstressed. In addition to adhering to preventive ways against the spread of COVID-19, There is the need to employ necessary management skills in coping with the challenges brought by the stay-at-home tendencies or policies and associated stress on homes and household resources. So now let us briefly look at the innovative Islamic ways of preventing the spread of COVID-19 vis-a-vis the effective home management. Islam, as a complete and comprehensive way of life, has laid down the entire rules and regulations governing the human conduct and management of family affairs. In one popular tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, a Jew approached one of the companions of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and retorted that, "I learned that your friend or your master is teaching you everything, including the etiquette of excretion." The companion replied that, "Of course, he used to enjoin us not to face Qibla or to turn back against it. He equally directed us to avoid the direction of wind flows and holes, therefore everything and holes." So this was the reply of this particular companion, that the Jew approached him and said to him that he learned that this, your man, referring to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is teaching you everything that you do, including how you go to ease yourselves for excretion in the toilet. He replied that, of course, he teaches everything, and that whenever we are going to ease ourselves to pass excretion, he commanded us neither to face Qibla, not to turn our back against it, and that we should avoid wind blow. If wind is blowing to a particular direction, you should not face it, so that wind will not blow to destroy your body or your garment. And likewise, we should avoid holes. When you go to bush to ease yourself and you see a hole, you shouldn't ease yourself inside that hole. So the import of this tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is to tell us that Islam is complete and comprehensive way of life, that everything is being provided for in Islam. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying that man faradna fil kitab min shay, that nothing is being left unturned in the book. That means in the glorious Quran, everything is being provided for. And therefore, one of the beauty of Islam is that all the genuine preventive ways against the spread of infections, including the COVID-19, are adequately outlined and provided for under Islamic Sharia. Some of the major ways of preventing the spread of COVID-19 pandemic in the light of Islam are as follows. These are some of the ways through which we can prevent the spread of the COVID-19 in the light of Islam. Number one is education and public enlightenment. That education occupies a very important position in Islam. Apart from the centrality of knowledge in the observance of Islam, Muslims are enjoined to always seek for knowledge on issues and not to engage in anything without having knowledge of its operation and Islamic injunctions about its observance. We know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoin us in the Holy Quran or inform us in the Holy Quran that وَلَا تَقَفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ إِلْمٍ, and that we know there are various traditions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informing us that everything that we do as Muslims, we should do it full of awareness. That means not blindly. That is why another verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying, Sheikh Usman bin Fodi was saying in Nur al-Arbab, "Ad-dinu mabniyyun 'ala at-tabassur 'ala ahli al-basair." So Islam is an enlightened religion, that a Muslim is not expected to do anything blindly. Therefore, trying to seek for knowledge about infectious disease, trying to as much as possible separate the knowledge, enlighten the general public about the causative measures, about the preventive measures and the dangers of the disease is one of the most fundamental ways of preventing the spread of COVID-19 in Islam. So everything is duly provided for in Islam. A Muslim should therefore not engage in anything without the knowledge of its operation and its etiquette governing it. We are aware of this popular saying of Sheikh Imam Abdurrahman Al-Ahdari that wala yahillu lahu an yaf'ala fi'lan hatta ya'lam hukm Allah fi, that a Muslim is not allowed to engage himself in anything without knowing the duly outlined rules and regulation of observing that particular thing. So knowledge is very central in Islam, and Islam enjoins us to seek for knowledge on what everything that we do. So this is the first preventive measure of the spread of COVID-19, public enlightenment. And I am sure this gathering is one of such public enlightenment measures to enlighten the general public about this disease, about how to prevent oneself against it, and at the same time, trying to prevent the spread of the disease. So in essence, educating the populace not only on Islamic injunctions, on the observance of religious rights, but general conduct of their public and private affairs is necessary. When that is achieved, the populace will be adequately informed, not only on the nature and danger of the COVID-19, but on the preventive measures, thus raising community awareness, preparedness, and resilience against the spread of the disease. This is the first mechanism. Then the next mechanism is avoiding infected persons or communities. That one of the critical measures considered necessary in avoiding the spread of COVID-19 pandemic has been cordoning the infected areas and or avoiding the movement of people from non-infected areas into those areas. We all know this is one of the measures taken since at the early appearance of this pandemic in Wuhan, China. That they quickly cordoned that affected province, and that was how they were able to, within a short period of time, overcome the spread of the disease. And the rest part of the world who got the disease from Wuhan suffered more from the disease than China itself, because they adopted this mechanism very seriously. And that was why they succeeded in wiping it out. So in Islam, it is an established ruling in Islam that as a Muslim, whenever there is pandemic in a particular community, you are not allowed to move into that community. And if you are in that community, you are not allowed to come out of that community, because by coming out, you will separate it. And by moving it, you will get infected. And this is an Islamic rule. So what China did sometime towards the end of the 2019 was fully in line with the teachings of Islam. This was practiced during the lifetime of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and it works. So it is interesting to note that this principle of lockdown or cordoning the areas infected with pandemic diseases is practiced by the Prophet of Islam Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam more than 1,400 years ago. Therefore, advances in modern sciences is only increasing the faith of the well-informed Muslims about the authenticity of the Quran as revealed book from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the authenticity of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a messenger sent to convey the message of the Holy Quran, and the authenticity of Islam as revealed religion. That is why you see advances in modern sciences are always giving us confidence that yes, Islam is a true religion. Because now, despite the advances of modern sciences, sometimes scientists of global repute will spend years conducting research to come out with an invention or discovery, only to know that this has been a common knowledge among the Muslims or is being mentioned in the Holy Quran. So it means that Quran must have been from supreme being, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created the world and know everything about it. Otherwise, if you look at the time when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came 1,400 years ago, it was even dark ages. Even the Arabian history, it was called Jahiliyyah period. So you cannot imagine somebody in Jahiliyyah period making scientific breakthroughs. So it's simply because this religion is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So another preventive mechanism from Islamic perspective against the spread of the disease is staying at home. Whereas people are enjoined not to move into areas affected by pandemic, those living in the area affected by the pandemic, on the other hand, are disallowed from coming out from those areas into the non-infected areas. In addition, also, even within the areas believed to have been infected with pandemic diseases, they are enjoined to as much as possible avoid intermingling in order to save those that are not impacted from their impacted neighbors. As long as it is established of the presence of a pandemic disease within a particular community, such precautionary measures as stay-at-home principle are sanctioned in Islam. Then there is also wearing of face masks covering the nose and the mouth. You see, this is another preventive measure of the spread of COVID-19 disease, that if at all you have a cause to come out from your home and address a particular need, then you are enjoined to take precautions. And that one of those precautions is to cover your face, particularly your nose and mouth. One will be surprised that in the Arab world, particularly in North Africa, it was part of their culture and tradition, even before the advent of Islam, that they do wear turban. And in addition, they do cover their nose and mouth, simply because of the hazards of their desert environment. And when Islam came, because that particular practice did not contravene the teachings of Islam or Islamic etiquette for dressing, Islam sanctioned it. And it today become a sunnah, a tradition of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to wear turban. So therefore, if wearing turban to uncovering your nose and mouth is allowed in Islam, or can even be argued to be sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then wearing face mask is equally allowed in Islam. So people living within areas impacted by COVID-19 are expected to observe this practice. And there is also the need to avoid contact with objects, particularly iron and silver, made objects in public places, that when you come out to public places, that you should try as much as possible to prevent to avoid iron and silver objects. Simply because the virus lasts longer on them than other objects such as the floor or wooden objects. And you know, in Islam, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prohibit men particularly from using silver and gold utensils in the houses. As at that time, the major thing which was visible about the wisdom behind that instruction was to avoid embezzlement. But today we are coming to realize there are health implications or health advantages in avoiding those type of objects. So you see there is regular washing of hands, which is also allowed in Islam. And that is why as a Muslim, you are enjoined that when you go to and ease yourself and perform tahara, that you should use sand to wash your hand. By then, so common among societies, but sand was used. And today we are made to believe that sand contain a lot of properties that do purify substances. That is why even the modern chemist will use carbon filter to purify water. It's just sands and gravels or coal inside the carbon filter. And you see, long ago, we were taught in Islam that whenever you come into contact with anything which is filthy, you should use sand to clean your hand. And that is why a dead person, when you are going to perform a ritual bath to a dead person, you are also enjoined to use magaria. That magaria has some element of soap in it and is disinfectant. So all these measures that are now brought forward by government or health specialists that you should use soap and running water, these are things that are being taught by Islam. And that is why as a Muslim, you have the advantage of at least washing your hands 5 times daily to perform wudu before you pray. So there is the need to avoid exposure to human and animal excretions. And that is why, you know, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam enjoined us not to pass excretion either along the road or under a shade of tree or in a hall. And simply because you see along the road, people do pass and can easily get infected. Likewise, under the shade of tree is a place where people are living and they can be infected. All these are steps and measures that are sanctioned by Islam that are also helpful and useful in preventing the spread of this disease. And there is a need to avoid pets, particularly dogs and cats during this type of period. You know, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was saying in one of the tradition that duhuru ina ahadukum iza walaga fihi al-kalbu an yaksilnahu sab'a marratin ulahun nabit turab, that when dog maybe act on your utensil or eat a food from your utensil, you should use sand to wash it 7 times. You know, you should wash it 7 times, and you should make sure that the first round of that washing of that utensil, you should use sand, because sand was so common and cheaper than soap. And that was why they were enjoined to use sand, instead of soap. So today, when you are enjoined to avoid some of these fats, because they do carry this infection as they do transmit it. Yes, so finally, you see, he tried to emphasize that there is need to raise the level of awareness. That he tried to emphasize the role of Muslim women in effective home management. Besides some of these measures, which are general for both men and women, women, which is the sole home manager, is also expected to employ a lot of measures that are sanctioned by Islam in order to prevent the spread of COVID-19. Woman is a wife and a helpmate. She is a home manager. As a home manager, she is expected to perform a lot of roles that will help in preventing the spread of COVID-19 pandemic. So finally, what the Sheikh is saying in conclusion, is that Islam as a religion is not only capable, but made adequate plans and provision to addressing human problems and in responding to challenges that could arise in life. As for the Muslim woman, ab initio, there is systematic division of labor and responsibilities by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala between men and man and women in family and home affairs. Whereas men go out to look for livelihood, women are expected to take care of domestic family needs associated with home management. Before gender and social division of labor, women is naturally created to shoulder domestic life of childbearing and rearing and other domestic affairs. So, alhamdulillah, this is the message the Sheikh is trying to tell us, that any genuine measure that you know is useful in preventing the spread of COVID-19, when you go back to the teachings of Islam, you find that it is sanctioned by Islam. Thank you, and assalamu alaikum.